Hello, and welcome to the Sparta Group podcast. We aim to provide you with up-to-date interviews and debate with opinion leaders in the health, well-being, rehabilitation, and mental health space, from our studio or from conferences.
Hello, my name is Steve Bennett from Sparta. Welcome to the latest in our question and answer sessions with Dr. Sandi Mann, Senior Psychology Lecturer at the University of Central Lancashire, expert workplace consultant, author of several books on psychology and human potential, who runs her own private clinic and is clinical psychology lead for Sparta Health. Hello again, Sandi.
Hey, Steve, how are you today?
Yeah, not so bad. Not
so still bad. All right.
Yeah. Ready for another informative and useful session with you.
Yeah, always interested too. Your questions always make me think.
Okay, well, this one might not be as challenging, I don't know, because it might relate more to the professional knowledge.
I've given you pressure now. I've put you under pressure now, haven't I?
You have.
Challenge me.
One of the things that I researched when I was writing my piece about happiness and human potential, one of the big sections that I wrote about was all about human needs and whether those needs are satisfied. And that's what I'd like to talk about today, if we can. Obviously, one of the first things, whenever you type human needs into Google or you do research on human needs, the name Abraham Maslow pops up because of his hierarchy of needs. For anyone that hasn't seen it, it essentially, as I understand it from a layman's terms, basically says that we have basic needs, which are things like food and water, etc. Then we've got things like our safety needs. It goes up in like a pyramid. And then you've got above that belonging and love, social needs, then there's our self-esteem, our comfort, rising up to the very top of the pyramid, which is a mysterious thing called self-actualization.
Which is a brilliant thing, self-actualization. You'll know, when I explain it, you'll know exactly what it is.
Oh, I can't wait.
It's a posh word.
It's the one element of human needs that I've never really understood. But I suppose the question that sits around this, particularly at this time, is that when so many of our human needs have actually been affected, restricted, suppressed due to the coronavirus lockdown, it's coping strategies with those elements being absent. You know, okay, we've been able to go and get food. That's classed as an essential. But our safety has been compromised. Our love lives, for those of us who have partners outside of our homes, has been compromised and it's now at a distance, and a sense of belonging to a community has struggled a little bit. And for many, many people that I've spoken to, their self-esteem has dipped dramatically. Well, I know self-esteem is a complicated subject in its own right, and I'd love to have a separate conversation with you, separate podcast on the self-concept, if you like, because I love that aspect. But a lot of people have suffered from that. So realistically, what I'm throwing out there is an open-ended question about coping with the deprivation of many of our human needs, whether it's through this crisis or through any other set of changes of circumstances.
Yeah, really, really good questions again. You made me think again. Maslow's hierarchy of needs. I have to just point out that a lot of people in my profession, a lot of psychologists don't like Maslow anymore. And he's been very much criticised in the hierarchy, that you have to go through this sort of strict hierarchy. But I'm with you, actually, Steve. You know, I like it. I like Maslow. I think it's very easy to understand. You've got your basic levels. And the idea of Maslow is that you need your basic level met. You need your security and your food and all that sort of met before you go on to the next level. So if you haven't got your food and your basics, you won't be interested in any levels above that. And obviously that has been criticised a lot now. And there are people who would go without the basic level in order to get higher levels like love and whatever. But it's still a nice concept, easy to understand. And then you've got this mysterious bit at the top, which is the self-actualization. So let me tell you what that is, because when I do, you'll go, oh, yeah, I knew that, because I know you'll know it. Self-actualization is just about reaching your potential. So it's that need that we have to reach our potential, to do things that are inherently satisfying. It's kind of that search for meaning that I think we've kind of alluded to in other podcasts. But humans have this need for meaning, and we don't just want to go to work in order to make money, but we want to go to work in order to feel satisfied. So it's that kind of feeling of satisfaction. Does Does that something you relate to that? I'm sure you
absolutely. Yeah. You mentioned something there that's just resonated with me. You mentioned the word search for meaning. Have you read Viktor Frankl?
Oh yes, yeah. We have the same publisher actually. We share a publisher in Spain.
What an amazing story that is. I don't know who's best to explain that for me or you from a professional term.
Yeah, you go for it.
Well, my understanding of it was that Viktor Frankl was an Auschwitz prisoner who wanted to make some meaning out of the period of incarceration. The big thing was he was a psychologist. I'm not sure whether he had qualifications in psychology before he went in there, but he certainly became a renowned psychologist in the years after his release. But essentially, I mean, there was one example that he gave which really resonated and stuck with me. He talked about it was towards the end of the incarceration, towards the end of the war, but nobody knew the actual end date. And there was one particular person, a co-prisoner of his, who was an orchestra, a band leader, very intelligent man. But in the months leading up to the Christmas period, I think it was in 1945, I could be corrected, this person was suffering a debilitating illness that was killing him. It was going to kill him anyway. But then the news came that they thought the war was going to end. And as a result, this person's health shot through the roof and he recovered almost fully. And when he was questioned about it, Frankl questioned him about it. He said, I had no meaning in my life. There was no meaning. My life is all about leading an orchestra, leading a band. There was no hope of that. So there was meaning and hope were two connected words there. He said, I had no meaning. He said, now there is a meaning. But unfortunately, after the Christmas period came, it seemed that a shadow was cast over that bit of news and that the war wasn't likely to end in the near future. And the person's illness returned. And within weeks, he was dead. Now, that was a very sad story. But it stuck with me. I mean, I read that 30 years ago, and it stuck with me a long, long time about man's search for meaning and our search for meaning. It's all about this. It's all about what we're talking about, human needs. And that self-actualization that you just talked about absolutely crystallized it for me. So thank you.
And the reason that Maslow's been criticized is what, if you think about it, the self-actualization is meant to be right at the top. In other words, according to Maslow, you're meant to meet all these other needs before you can even think of self-actualization. And it's true, you know, we've got to get off food, we've got to have those basic security needs met. But there's still a lot of people who would give up the other layers of stuff in order to self-actualize. And I see this in business a lot. You see people who give up well-paid jobs with security and high status, and they give it all up. And then they go and work in a fish and chippy or something, or they set up a little business where they're struggling to survive, but they're feeling satisfied and, you know, it's the lifestyle that they want. You know, so we will do almost anything to self-actualize.
I know people have jumped those steps. Yeah. I know people who have, for example, one of the lower levels is money, is having cash to be able to buy things. Yeah. Well, I know people that have given up almost all their money for the love of another person. Yeah.
So that's why sometimes Maslow is criticized, but I still think it's a nice, neat idea. And, you know, generally it's got a nice flow to it. But to go back to your original sort of thoughts on this in terms of now and on human needs and in the period that we're coming out of with lockdown and going forward and not knowing what's going to be happening. And I think it's certainly true that some people are going to be much more severely or have been much more severely affected because they are not able to have those higher needs met. Some people, most of us hopefully, have had our lower needs met. Although at the beginning there was panic obviously about food and that sort of thing. But hopefully, and jobs and things, I like to think that most people have got food on the table. Although I know things can be very difficult for some people in terms of work and employment. But you talk about sense of community, you've got to work much harder at that now, that sense of belonging. But it is still possible. I'm speaking to a lot of people, and interesting, a lot of my clients have got more of a sense of belonging, more of a sense of community now, because they can connect to more people across the globe in a way that they couldn't do before. And it's easier. They don't have to make as much effort. You just switch your computer on. You go to Zoom meetings. And there's a lot of communities that are doing so many things. You can go to Zumba. You can go to coffee mornings and have virtual wine tastings and cheese tastings, all sorts of things you can do online without actually leaving your house. So you can get that sense of community, but you need to work harder at it. But I think the real problem for some people is, as you said, again, hit the nail on the head, which is with what we call self-actualization, or what Maslow calls self-actualization, but the search for meaning. And if you're in a profession or your life revolves around something that isn't there anymore, I don't know, for example, if you work in the tourist industry, that's really been massacred at the moment. But you're in an industry where you can't flex your work and go online and change your way of working, or it's much more difficult to do so. It's very easy to lose that sense of self. And we talk about the self-concept, but a lot of it is made up of who we are and what we do. And it can be very, very difficult to change that. I remember reading about this pilot who was furloughed from one of the airlines, you know, right at the beginning, and he got a job as a delivery driver for one of the supermarkets.
I read that yesterday.
Yeah, and I just thought, wow, you know, that is really, really amazing, because you've got such an identity. A pilot has a real strong identity, and it's a skilled job, and, you know, it's the sort of thing where I think you do have a certain status with that. And I don't think you have quite that same status as a delivery driver, although you probably should, because they're real essential key workers. I think they are being welcomed with open arms now, or virtually opened arms, when you get see delivery driver bringing your food now. But still, it's a big adjustment. It's a big change. And some people could really find that difficult. You know, they've lost that self-identity. They've lost that sense of self.
I just hope that when we come through all of this on the other side of it, that people remember some of the heartwarming feelings that we've experienced as a result of the changes. I mean, one of the things that I used to make me angry was when you go into a restaurant and you see somebody lambasting a waiter or a waitress and almost treating them as if they're a second-class person. I hate that. I hate injustice of any description, but that sort of injustice against humans really does annoy me. Seeing people being victimized because of the status that somebody perceives that they hold. Now, whether it's that person is from an upper class background or whether he's from a lower class background, middle class, doesn't make any difference. The person you're speaking to deserves at least respect. And this pilot and the delivery driver change of roles is a perfect example.
Yeah, and he's got my respect for sure. There was another one, I think, of an opera singer who, obviously, theatre and opera is something that's really, really going to be struggling for a long time. And they got a job, I think it was a she got a job in Lidl, I think, stacking shelves. And good luck, you know, I think it's fantastic. And, you know, I've got great respect for them. But I think what it all boils down to is self-actualization and this ability to find meaning. And if you've lost that meaning because your role has now gone or gone temporarily, how do you find that again? And these are really good examples of people who have found it again, who have found meaning in doing something different. Like you say, I hope that we still value those roles and that we continue to. And I think what you've raised there is actually something very interesting, and in that we are perhaps, as a society, I hope, changing our perception about what meaning is. So, you know, whereas before it might have been status and money and high status professions that were more meaningful, I'd like to think that now we're seeing those delivery drivers and the supermarket workers who we so desperately need, and obviously the NHS staff and carers, as the people with the most meaning in life, not the people that we met previously.
Yes. Do you understand? Absolutely, yeah. I always hold the belief that what's less important is what you do. What's more important is who you are as a person. And that's what we don't know. When that delivery person is walking down our driveway, we don't know who that person is. We don't know what makes up their life. We don't know what their history is. We have no right to judge. And yet we do so easily, or we have done previously. And my biggest hope is that for humanity's sake, that changes in the future, you know, because I think, you know, we went through decades of the information age, and they reckon that we advanced more in the last 30 years than we have in the last 300 years. You know, compressed into a short space of time. And what that's meant is that people are running at a faster pace, and people are less considerate of one another. People are more selfish than selfless. And I'm hoping
judgmental, don't you think?
People are judgmental. Yeah, well, I'm hoping a lot of that will reverse. I mean, you know, it is optimistic, I know, because people will have their own concerns, but
we have to be optimistic. That comes back to what you're saying about hope. You know, optimism is about hope, and we have to. We always have to. You know, I always say at this difficult time, and right at the beginning, you know, 10 weeks ago, we're 10 weeks in now. You know, when everything was closing down, it was seemed just awful, and everybody was in shock, and I think we were grieving. You know, we were really grieving for what we'd lost. And I always said we've just got to be optimistic. We've got to have hope, because without optimism, without hope, what's left? And that brings us right back to your Viktor Frankl story. You know, it's hope and optimism that keeps us going. So be optimistic, be hopeful.
Well, I mean, the one message I would hope that the world gets, not from our podcast, because they're not going to see this, but not the whole world anyway.
You never know.
No, well, I hope so. But I mean, the one message I hope the world would pick up on is that it's been said in the past, one person can't make a difference. Well, yes, they can, because one person can influence another 10, and those 10 can influence another 10. And in that way, we can change our world. We can change our world to be a more optimistic and hopeful and loving place to live, you know, and that's my hope for the future.
Yeah, I share that. And if there's one message, I know we've gone a little bit off track from needs, but if there's one message that we can send, it's let's all be kind and spread kindness, you know, pay it forward.
Certainly that subject that we talked about at the beginning, needs, is very important at this very end of the conversation, because if we apply all of these principles of love and care and compassion, there is a greater chance that the elements that you need in your life will come to you. You know, the love, the money, the food, the self-esteem, all of those elements to help create that self-actualization at the top. They're less likely to happen if we're negative. They're less likely to happen if we are fearful and if we are not considerate of our fellow man. But anyway, that's been a wonderful session. I enjoyed that, and it was far more detailed than I expected it to be.
Well, we went off tangents, but I kind of like that, you know, that we're just musing and thinking, and you know, it's a bit like a conversation down the pub without the beer, really, isn't it?
Yeah, that's for another time.
Yeah, I say we'll have to do that one next time. Get your beer next time.
Yeah. Okay, well, I'll bring this one to a close then. Thank you very much indeed again, Sandi, for a wonderful contribution. Nice and one. We've got another exciting subject coming up in a moment, but I'll leave that as a teaser.
Can't wait.
Okay, see you next time. Bye-bye.
At Sparta Group, we are keen to hear your thoughts about the topics discussed today. So please tweet us @Sparta_health or visit our website for more information and support.